Hello everyone, this is Bob Souza speaking from historic Main Street in Somerset Village. We here at TV9, Somerset Access Television, are very proud to present the great accomplishments of the greatest fielder as a third baseman ever in the history of Major League Baseball, Brooks Robinson. Brooks joined the Baltimore Orioles in the Orioles' second year of existence in 1955. They originally were the St. Louis Browns before they moved to Baltimore in 1954. The last 3 years of the Browns, 1951, 52, 53, they were owned and operated by Bill Veeck, one of the great innovators in baseball, one of the great entertainers. Bill Veeck spent all his money on the players. However, the fans didn't come to Sportsman Park in St. Louis to support the Browns because they would lose 100-some-odd games a year. In 1951, he had a great pitcher, Ned Garver, who won 20 games, sometimes played the outfield because he was one of their better hitters. The Browns only won 52 games, and Garver, as I said, won 20 of those 52. Also, one of the great accomplishments in the entertainment league was the pinch hitting of Eddie Gaedel, the midget, 3'5", 7-inch player who was signed to a one-day contract for $100. Eddie Gaedel faced Bob Kane of the Detroit Tigers, leading off the second game of a doubleheader. Both teams were at the bottom of the standings, the Tigers in seventh place, the Browns in eighth place. Watching Bob Kane, left-hander for the Tigers, warm up prior to the game, Eddie Gaedel said to Bill Veeck from the owner's box, he said, "I think I can hit this guy, Bill." Bill said, "If you do, I'll shoot you dead right in the batter's box where you stand. You get up there and crouch and take four pitches for a walk." The strike zone, which was about 2 inches in length and width, caused him to get a walk. The only fella who has 1,000 percentage as on-base accomplishments in the history of baseball. The other noteworthy individual with the Browns, 1952, won 12 games, 47-year-old Satchel Paige, star of the Negro Leagues, who was brought up as a 42-year-old rookie by Bill Veeck when Bill owned the Cleveland Indians in 1948. The moving force in Baltimore to acquire the franchise was Mayor of Baltimore Tom D'Alessandro. He headed a group of businessmen who purchased the Browns for $2.5 million. They were to open in 54 in Baltimore's Memorial Stadium. At the age of 14, daughter of D'Alessandro was an interested spectator in all this. Her name was Nancy, age 14. I myself was 16, so I knew a lot about that situation. Nancy later went to school and moved to California, married a fella named Pelosi. So from Nancy D'Alessandro, she became Nancy Pelosi, and representative from California, and of course, Speaker of the House of Representatives from 2007-2011. Today, she's the majority leader in the House of Representatives for the Democratic Party. So that was the beginning of the Baltimore Orioles. For Brooks Robinson, our individual leader today and Hall of Famer, 1983, spent 23 years with the Orioles from 1955 to 1977. In 1983, he was inducted into the Baseball Hall of Fame. He was called the Human Vacuum Cleaner. Made the All-Star team 18 different times in his 23-year career, and Gold Glove Award for Best Fielding Third Baseman 16 consecutive years. He was most valuable in the league 1964 as Baltimore's third baseman. And of course, a great star in World Series competition 1966, playing for manager Hank Bauer. His Orioles defeated the Los Angeles Dodgers 4 straight games. 1970, they played the Cincinnati Reds. First time World Series games were played on AstroTurf, and in 5 games, the Baltimore Orioles beat the Cincinnati Reds. The most valuable player in that World Series was Brooks Robinson, batting 429. In 1969 and 1971, defeats occurred for the Orioles. They lost to the upstart New York Mets in the World Series of 1969. 5 games, and the Mets won behind Tom Seaver and Jerry Kuzman. And in 1971, the great work of Roberto Clemente and the Pittsburgh Pirates defeated the Orioles in 7 games. We will have the World Series highlights of 1966, 1969, 1970, and 1971 in our film today. The narrator, George Plimpton, does an excellent job hitting fungo balls to our man Brooks Robinson at third base. George appeared as a host earlier in our series when he hosted the video along with Willie Stargell on Roberto Clemente. And we have also doing the play-by-play broadcast, Hall of Fame Philadelphia Phillies announcer Harry Callis, famous for his out-of-here call on home run balls. He replaced John Facenda as the voice of NFL sports. So we have a beautiful video which first appeared in 1981.
You got to get your glove over there. Get it in a position to catch the ball. Don't wait till the last second. Get your glove down as soon as you can. Make sure your glove's on the ground. Don't run up to the ball.
My name is George Plimpton. Today's legend made third base his home for 22 years, winning 16 Golden Gloves during that period. Some say he patrolled the area between third base and shortstop as if it was his front yard and guarded the hot corner as he would his own front door. You're about to take a look at the career of the most brilliant fielding third baseman in the history of baseball, Brooks Robinson.
Too bad, huh, George?
Oh, the magic is still there, isn't it?
Well, it sort of, but everything does look a little further away now.
Does it? Looks like about 8 miles to me, I'll tell you that. Is one born with an arm like that?
I think it's something you can develop over a while. I know that I started working on my arm many years ago back in Little Rock when I used to go by a fellow by the name of Bill Dickey, the great catcher Yankee for the New York Yankees. He was on my paper route. I used to flip a paper, and most of the time it'd be on the roof. So my arm started getting a little stronger a long time ago.
When does one first know that you have a small chance at any rate of getting into the major leagues? Is there a moment that you say, well, listen, I've got a crack at it?
I think the moment that I felt like I had a crack at it is when the first scout came and talked to me about signing with a big league team.
I suppose you can tell when there's a scout sitting up there in the stands, can you? You get all sort of shivery there at third base.
Well, all the kids knew that. I mean, a big league scout, that was the most exciting thing that can ever happen to you. So, but there were scouts. We had several scouts in the Little Rock area, and they were always out the ballpark, and I guess that the first time I realized I had a chance is when one came down and said, hey, Brooks, you know, when you get out of high school, we think maybe we'd like to take a chance and sign you.
No, but the Orioles finally did sign you, though.
That's right. When I graduated in high school, there were, there were 16 big league teams, and out of the 16, eight of them had talked to me, and none of them wanted to offer me a lot of money to sign, so I signed for $4,000, which was my salary for the year. And the reason I signed with the Orioles was because the St. Louis Browns had just moved to Baltimore, and they became the Baltimore Orioles. And Paul Richards, who was the manager, he said, hey, Brooks, he said, look, if you have any ability at all, he said, you're going to get a chance to play very early in your career because we don't have much talent.
What is the ingredient that makes one team better than another suddenly, rises it up to a...
I don't think anybody has the real answer to it. I've seen great clubs that just never won, but in the Orioles' particular case, it was having Frank Robinson join our club in 1966. He just really put us over the hump and made us a better ball club than anybody else in the American League.
The two Robinsons carry the Orioles into the World Series against the National League champion Los Angeles Dodgers. In the first inning, with one out, Frank hit a two-run homer over the left field wall. Brooks stepped up next and performed his version of the long ball, cracking Don Drysdale's pitch into the lower left field stands. The Orioles went on to win the game 3-2. Things did not improve much for the Dodgers in game two. Even wishful thinking by Dodger manager Walter Alston could not change a growing sense of frustration.
No score, fifth inning. Koufax's pitch. Blair swings, fly ball, center field. Willie Davis is right there, backtracking. He waits. Davis drops the ball. Here's Boone Powell heading for third, and Blair ends up at second base. An uncharacteristic Willie Davis error. That'll bring on Andy Etchebarren. Koufax's pitch. Swing, fly ball, shallow center. Powell at third. Davis coming on. He drops it again. Boone Powell's going to score. Throw to third. Overthrows there. Baltimore gets two gift runs. Leads 2-0.
Dodger fans could not be pleased watching Baltimore coast to their second straight win. Watching, unbelieving at the Dodger inability to put their bats on the ball. Games 2 and 3 were carbon copies for the Dodgers. Goose eggs. As Game 4 approached, L.A. hoped they could break out of their series-long doldrums. They had not scored since the third inning of Game 1, running their consecutive inning scoreless streak to 24. Maury Wills' leadoff strikeout symbolized what was going wrong. Even when they got their bats on the ball, they were unfortunate enough to hit the ball at the wrong people. Dodgers just couldn't score, and after 8 2/3 innings, there they were down to their last batter.
Orioles lead 1-0. The pitch to Lou Johnson. Fly ball center field. This should be it. Paul Blair is there waiting. Squeezes it. Baltimore, the world champs, and they shut out Los Angeles 33 straight innings, a series record.
We were underdogs. We were facing the Dodgers and Drysdale and Koufax, and they had been there a couple times before, and that's why I say you really never know what's going to happen in a World Series, but that had to be the most exciting time. The first one, you always, as a kid, dream about getting to the big leagues and being on a pennant winner, getting in a World Series and winning, and we accomplished all those things in 66, but the first time up off of Drysdale when I hit the home run, I just, that did it.
Big
Things can really turn around, can't they, in baseball? 67, all of a sudden you went downhill.
Well, we did, in a hurry. 67 was a long year for us, and I think one of the main things, Frank Robinson got hurt about the middle of the year and missed most of the last half. And then 68, Earl Weaver took over from Hank Bauer midway in the season. They felt like they needed a change to try to spur the guys on. You know, you can always, you can't fire the players, you got to fire the manager. But there was a good move for the Orioles because Earl Weaver stayed there for a long time and had a lot of success.
Of course, Weaver had some awfully good people to manage, didn't he? 69.
Well, yes, he did. In fact, I don't think Earl Weaver really got his just dues, George, till the last few years that he's managed. And, you know, he had, everybody said, well, you should win. We won in 69, 70, and 71. You got Frank Robinson, you got Boog Powell, Davey Johnson, Paul Blair, Cuellar, McNally. And I think it was not till after a few years that Weaver really started getting the dues, the just dues, as far as him being an outstanding manager. And I've seen him win with some ball clubs that I didn't think they had that much talent, and he was able to pull it off.
But what was the famous Kangaroo Court in 69 it started, wasn't it?
Yes, it did. And it was kind of something to relieve the tension or help bring the guys a little closer because we hadn't won in several years. And it really turned out to be a bonanza for the whole ball club. And we only held the court after each winning game. And Frank Robinson was a judge. He had a mop, the mop part of it you put over your head to look like a judge, and we found he would call the court to order, and he would fine guys for missing a sign or maybe making a base running blunder, and we had about four or five articles that we passed out, but it was all done in good taste, and all the fines that were collected during the year were passed out to a charitable organization at the end of the year. But we had a good time, and it really seemed to bring us a little closer. That was the first year they had the playoffs too, George, and we won three in a row from Minnesota, and I think at that particular time the Mets were also winning the playoffs, and we met in the 1969 World Series.
The Mets versus the Orioles was an ideal confrontation, featuring Frank Robinson, Paul Blair, Brooks Robinson, and Met pitcher Tom Seaver. The first game was all Orioles. In the fourth inning, with Baltimore leading 1-0, Mark Belanger singled to right field, scoring Hendricks and sending Johnson to third. Mike Cuellar, the pitcher, followed with a run-scoring single to left center. The Orioles scored once again in the fourth, enough to carry them to a 4-1 victory. Game two, also at Baltimore, was a pitching duel, and the Mets staff proved superior. Jerry Koosman went 8 2/3 innings, and Ron Taylor came in to get the last out to give the New Yorkers a 2-1 win. With the series tied 1-1, the Mets prepared to play in front of their faithful, who had waited 9 long years for this moment. Famous faces sought to be identified with destiny's darlings, while America shared in the glory of an underdog turned top dog. Met fans expressed themselves in typical New York fashion, taunting the frustrated birds who could do nothing right. Baltimore continually lost battles with Met pitchers. They didn't do much better with the home plate umpires either, predictably losing their arguments. Meanwhile, for the Mets, everything went right. They really were invincible.
Game five, ninth inning. Mets lead 5-3. Davey Johnson batting for Baltimore. Jerry Koosman stretches. Pitch to Johnson. Swing, a drive to deep left center field. Leon Jones is there. Makes the catch, and the amazing Mets are the 69 World Champs.
Very disappointing to lose. You always think you're the best ball club, but after it's all over, you can sit back and say, well, anything can happen in a short series. Let's go on and see what happens next year. And it was like a year-long run for redemption. At least that's the way I felt about it. And we're back in the World Series against the big red machine of Cincinnati, who had been mowing everybody down in the National League and had guys such as Johnny Bench and Rose and They just had an outstanding ball club over there. So I knew it was going to be one of those World Series where there's going to be a lot of hitting and a lot of scoring.
Okay, Randy.
Good play. That was good, Randy. I tell you, the big thing when you make a play like this where you might have to backhand it or catch it over here is to make sure you watch the ball in your glove. This is the toughest play for an infielder, is catching the ball back over here. Let me show you how it's done.
You gonna show me how it's done?
I'm gonna try.
I'll bet you can't.
All right.
All right, here you go.
Very funny, George. I tell you, 20 years ago, I would have had that one, too.
Okay, Brooks, here's a more legitimate one for you.
Oh, yes! Randy, that's how you do it, more or less, but the main thing is to stay down on the ball, watching your glove. Good luck to you.
Thanks.
All right. Hi, George.
Well done.
Thank
you. Was that a nice, clean put out, that one? Did it remind you of the last out of the 1970 series?
That was a great moment, I'll tell you, for me.
What was the difference between that series and the one in 69?
Well, I would say more than anything else, George, I got a chance, you know, to make the plays, and I was just in the right spot at the right time. I played almost 23 years professionally, and I never had a chance to make as many good plays as I did in that particular World Series.
The 1970 series pitted Cincinnati against Baltimore. In game one, Brooks Robinson proved to be the difference.
Sixth inning, Palmer's pitch to May. Swing, a shot down the third base. I want to grab Brooks Robinson to throw. He is out, an incredible play. Brooks Robinson, the batter. Score tied at 3, seventh inning. Swing and a long drive to deep left field. It's got a chance. Out of here, home run Robinson.
Brooks's home run gave the Birds a 4-3 win to go one up in the series. In game two, Brooks continued to perform superbly, frustrating the Reds with one defensive gem after another. The Orioles carried a 6-5 lead going into the ninth inning, where they promptly shut the door on Cincinnati. Game three was next. The Birds led 4-1 in the sixth inning when Paul Blair singled up the middle. Brooks was up next. He hit a line double down the left field line, sending Blair to third. Reds then elected to walk David Johnson to load the bases.
Pitcher Dave McNally at the plate. Orioles lead 4-1. Bases loaded. Pitch to him. Swing, a drive to left field. It's got a chance. It's back. It is gone. A grand slam home run. Pitcher Dave McNally has hit a slam, and the Orioles lead 8-1.
McNally's grand slam helped the Orioles take a 3-0 game lead in the series. Game four was a showcase for the slugger. In the second inning, with the Reds leading 1-0, Brooks Robinson tied the score with a home run off Gary Nolan, his second of the series. But the big blow of the game was not hit by an Oriole. In the eighth inning, the score was Orioles 4, Reds 3. With two runners on, Lee May came up to the plate facing relief pitcher Eddie Watt. He hit Watson's first pitch into the seats, giving the Reds their first series victory. The Orioles hope they can wrap up the series in Game 5 at Baltimore. Frank Robinson got them going by delivering a two-run homer in the very first inning. By the ninth inning, the Orioles led 8-3. Any ray of hope for the Reds was smothered by the magic of Brooks Robinson's glove.
Mike Cuellar has an 8-3 lead, two outs in the ninth inning. Pat Corrales, the batter. Ground ball hit to the vacuum at third. Brooks Robinson throws. He's out. And the Baltimore Orioles have won the World Series.
Brooks' performance earned him the MVP, and it prompted manager Sparky Anderson to say simply, Robinson beat us.
What about 71? Why is it that a team which wins the championship the next year comes back and really has a lot of difficulty?
It's awful tough to win back-to-back, and we had a shot at it. I thought we were going to win. We won the first two games in Baltimore against Pittsburgh. Ran away with them, in fact, and we went to Pittsburgh, and all we had to do was really win one over there, and we'd had a pretty good chance.
But their chances were doomed by one man. His name, Roberto Clemente. Clemente's performance enabled the Pirates to win three straight at Pittsburgh, and in the seventh and final game, he led the Pirates to the World Series championship.
Clemente was fantastic, and the thing that I admired about Clemente is to hear about how great a guy is. And I only played against Clemente in All-Star games and spring training games. And to hear about what a guy can do and then get in a World mm-hmm. Series, a showcase of baseball, and to have him do those very things to you, it just amazed me. And that's what he did, not only with the bat, but in the field with his arm. And he just put on a show that people are not going to forget.
For 20 years in the major leagues, Brooks Robinson also put on a show that people will never forget. 16 Golden Gloves tell part of the story, but facts and records are never adequate to describe a great talent. To truly appreciate Brooks Robinson, one had to see him in action, because plainly stated, he was the greatest fielding third baseman of all time.
To conclude our program, we just like to review the all-time leader in third base fielding in the history of Major League Baseball, Brooks Robinson. Played the most games of any third baseman, 2,870. Had the best fielding average, 971. The most putouts, 2,697. The most assists, 6,205. And participated in the most double plays by a third baseman, 618, and by far the greatest fielding third baseman ever in the history of Major League Baseball. Another tradition which occurred in Baltimore at Memorial Stadium in 1974, and even in today's world at Camden Yards, which has been in operation since 1992, the music supplied for the seventh inning stretch is John Denver's Thank God I'm a Country Boy. And the fans participate eagerly in this, dancing on the dugout of the Orioles and singing along with John Denver's recording. This is the conclusion of our program. For Brooks Robinson, we'll not only be going behind third base to make a brilliant play, but we'll be rounding third and heading home. Thank you.
Well, life on the farm is kind of laid back. Ain't much an old country boy like me can't hack. It's early to rise, early in a sack. I thank God I'm a country boy. Well, a simple kind of life never did me no harm. Raising me a family and working on the farm. Days are all filled with an easy country charm. Thank God I'm a country boy. Well, I got me a fine wife, I got me old fiddle. When the sun's coming up, I got cakes on the griddle. Life ain't nothing but a funny, funny riddle. Thank God I'm a country boy. When the work's all done and the sunset low, pull out my fiddle and the rosin up the bow. Kids are asleep, so I keep a catalog. And thank God I'm a country boy. I'd play Sally Gooden all day if I could, but the Lord and my wife wouldn't take it very good. So I fiddle when I can, work when I should. And thank God I'm a country boy. diamonds or jewels. I never was one of them money-hungry fools. Rather have my fiddle and my farming tools. Thank God I'm a country boy. Yeah, city folk driving in a black limousine. A lot of sad people thinking that's a mighty keen. Son, let me tell you now exactly what I mean. I thank God I'm a country boy. Me a fine wife, I got me old fiddle. When the sun's coming up, I got cakes on a griddle. Life ain't nothing but a funny, funny riddle. Thank God I'm a country boy, yeah. But my daddy's till the day he died. And he took me by the hand, held me close to his side. Said to live a good life, play my fiddle and cry. And thank God you're a country boy. Well, my daddy taught me young how to hunt and how to whittle. Taught me how to work and play a tune on a fiddle. Taught me how to love and how to give just a little. And thank God I'm a country boy. Well, I got me a fine wife, I got me old fiddle. When the sun's coming up, I got cakes on the griddle. Life ain't nothing but a funny, funny riddle. Country boy, yeah!